Well, here's some folks from the senior center. They could probably tell more about it.
It's a community clinic. They do it every year.
Okay. Yeah, so everybody is invited. And what time is that? 5 o'clock? Is like a potluck or?
No. Bring your
towel. On August 12th.
Give me some of that, take a bit.
What's on the 13th?
The fun day at the park. The water slides are going to be set up for kids. And there'll be root beer floats for a dollar. And it's Simpatico that will be sponsoring it. 4:30 to 6:30. Yes, 4:30 to 6:30. And tomorrow at the senior center from 11 to 7 is a blood drive.
People are going to be drawing blood. Well, come on, everybody, somebody's got questions. We've had so much going on the last few weeks.
I'd like to know how many poles went down this year.
So far.
It
was 9 behind the fire station.
Yeah, but I think it went
right. We had 5 down, and then there was 4 further.
17,
I think it was 17 the first time, and 82 the second.
The second time, I think it ended up, originally said 5, I think it ended up, there was a split, and I think it was a 9 or something, the second time, too. You would think that would have had just about every pole replaced up to here, but...
Last year, because there are some that still see
Well, you know, I talked to ATS when they were very helpful during both of those, and you know, they came out with the dry ice. They kept an open line of communication to the town manager and myself, and you know, so we kind of knew what was going on pretty much, you know, anytime we called, they were giving us an update. They were very helpful. And I asked that question about the poles because, you know, the folklore or the, you know, the history of that, they say that they won't replace the poles until they're broke and the insurance pays for the poles or whatever. Now, that's what I asked. And they said, no, that's not correct, that they're, you know, basically self-insured, so to speak. So they pay for the poles when they replace them. It's not just covered by insurance. So, and I said, well, it seems to me like it would be, and probably the rest of the community, that it seems more likely or it would be cost effective just to go through and replace them, you know. So there's nothing going on instead of we have these outages, and then I can't imagine the cost and overtime and equipment and things like that. And they said, well, you know, just the way they do business pretty much. And that they don't have the capital to go through and replace all the poles.
That's your raise our rates.
Well, yeah. So, it's like we're kind of stuck with the problem, I guess.
But you can go out again, because I'm all set now. All I have to go out and push the button. So now that I'm all ready.
You are insurance.
Well, we know where to go, man.
Good question. When we had the first power outage, I missed coffee with cops because I was babysitting a generator, but fortunately Rita came, and she got the information from you about how long we were going to be down. When I tried calling the ATS number before she left to come, it was off, and I got the impression from the message I was listening to that they didn't want to have to enter everybody in town.
Yeah, I don't know.
Is there a different number? Is there somewhere to call here? You say the town, information?
Yeah, you can call here and probably get probably as good or maybe better update. I don't know. You know, as long as we're getting it. But they've made a point to make sure that we have the right numbers to call people. And I've got about, you know, three cell numbers where I can call someone. And they would get really mad if I put them out to the public.
No, as long as there's someplace.
So it's 928-602.
What's the line number? That's how I got in trouble last time.
Heat warning for the next 2 days. So I'd like to remind everybody again to check their neighbors and do whatever it takes.
Yeah, I heard yesterday I heard somebody say 114 or 15 here. I don't know what.
Well, and with the humidity, a lot of people swap coolers. Right. What I've been relying on is a moot point right now.
Yeah.
So all we can really rely on is each other at this point for the next 2 days.
And you know, that was brought up earlier by Steve. You know, Steve? So many people crammed in here. Steve Hardy. He was asking about, you know, one of his neighbors or whatever, how, you know, sometimes when people go away in the winter, they'll put up a no trespassing sign or whatever on the property. And he says, you know, well, you know, that also could be an invitation, you know, to people. And, you know, it is kind of true in a way, you know, that, you know, you don't want people on there. But in this, an area where we do have people who leave for a long time, sometimes just the physical appearance of the house is kind of it can be an invitation to people who want to vandalize or burglarize. And I think the best thing, and we had just talked briefly about, but what you brought up about checking with your neighbors. You know, for those of us who are here year-round, you pretty much know who your neighbors are and if they're gone for the summer, and sometimes you know when they might be back. And still the best thing is, you know, is a neighbor watch type thing, you know, neighbors checking on neighbors. And even if they're, you know, even if you're not gone and you have neighbors, it's, you know, the best thing for us to do is just, you know, be aware of who's there. And we don't hear from them for, you know, you typically see your neighbor out, you know, come out once a day and you don't see him, you know, give us a call, we'll check on him. But, you know, we can be much more effective with a lot of numbers checking on each other. So, and I think that gets done a lot here. You know, we get calls all the time from a neighbor that, you know, says, hey, I didn't see so-and-so, and you come out and check on them.
Do we have that citizens patrol that comes around to all the
parks? Yeah.
Monday.
Is it Monday?
On Mondays, yeah. Okay. Yeah, on Mondays, Marilyn, and I don't know, she always has somebody.
Marianne.
Probably.
We're going to put a GPS on Nella so we know where she's at.
Yeah.
We'll put a GPS on her. She gave us a scare the other day.
Oh. Yeah, well, we're all glad to see Nella back. I think she's got a lot of people looking out after her. She hasn't realized it yet, but there's a lot of people looking out for her.
It takes a village.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think the Main Street Eatery up there, I think that's become a pretty regular place for you, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Mella.
Mella, you're
talking. You're talking about the eatery. You've been hanging at the eatery? Yeah. She's nodding. Big booch then.
Well, I guess we do more good weeks of the hot weather, huh? Make it through the next month, 4 to 6 weeks, and then boy, smooth sailing.
This is only our third summer here, but I found that if you're starting to feel a little warmer than you want to, turn on table. They always tell you it's cooler than it really is.
Yeah.
I that July and August, I see 108. I look at the thermometer, it's 115. You feel so much better listening to their voice.
So, come on. Lots of questions out there. Joe?
Yes, sir. I heard, I kind of seen this, but we have people, some of the people were not complaining, but they were worried. They didn't see any police cars the last couple of days. I have, but they're worried about coverage, you know, and I think I saw some DPS and Sheriff's Department making drive-bys and whatnot, so we're covered, aren't we? I mean, that's what I've been telling people.
Well, would you like to be? We're
going to don't think so.
Oh, don't start with that.
We need some good people. You know, it'd be a good opportunity to talk a little bit about what's going on, you know, over the past several weeks and let you know about, because there's been a lot of misinformation that has went out. One of the key things was DPS put out a small press release, and it said basically that the sheriff's, the Powell County Sheriff's Department was the one that was primarily responsible for calls for service here in Quartzsite. That is certainly not the fact. That came out after a number of our police officers were placed on administrative leave. And totally false release of information. I talked to Director Holloway, with DPS, Halliday, I'm sorry, and we kind of worked through that. Some of that was just a misinformation type thing, and we talked on the phone a couple of times. He's assured us that if we need assistance from DPS, we will have it. It's always there. It's nothing has changed. The Sheriff's Department, the same thing. You know, they have people in the area. If we need assistance from them, we can draw upon them as well. And Parker PD as well. If there came a situation where we needed additional officers, they'd be more than willing to come down here and help us. We have in that situation, nor do we expect to. We still have adequate police to provide the services necessary down. The calls for service are being provided on a regular, timely manner. You know, if the question is, do we have enough police officers out there with the Quartzsite Police Department to serve you guys? Yes, we do. And you know, the ones that are out here working are working very hard at that. Working a little harder than maybe they normally would. You know, when we have you know, there's sometimes during the day when we have maybe three officers on. You know, one of them is a canine. You know, we have two officers assigned to task force. So really, this reduction, the biggest impact it's having for us is it's limiting the interdiction and the canine services that we can provide and having officers assigned to the task force. So, but the bottom line is we are providing services, and I've had people say they've even seen an increase in services. They're seeing police more often. And that they're getting even better service, but maybe that's just because those that are still out here doing this are spending a lot more time out in the field. So
we're seeing the moral thing too low.
Yeah.
Well, and I think it comes back to the subject of loyalty. Without the disharmony, if you will, without the disharmony, it doesn't. You know, where two or more are gathered. So because of the loyalty, we're feeling the benefits that come from a loyal group, and I appreciate that very much.
Well, I think you're absolutely right, and you know, the situation that we're going through is certainly a difficult situation. It's difficult for the police department. It's difficult for the individuals that are in our families, and it's difficult for this community. And you know, unfortunately, what's going on has created, I'm going to say division, but I really don't like to say that, because what I see for the most part in the mainstream community of Quartzsite is that there is still a lot of support for the police department. And, you know, and we'll get through this. And I think that, you know, people in general have confidence that whatever the problems are, that we'll take care of them, and that in the end we will, you know, we will fix things. Whatever is broke, fix. And in the end, we'll have a much better, you'll have a much better department out here. Any other specific questions about that situation? I'll be glad to answer what I can.
I have a question.
Is there anywhere people can take their animals when their power goes out and keep them cold?
Joe's house.
That's a cold situation, and
because
the,
they can't have them in the city,
right?
Right.
Not
No,
you can bring them to my place. I have a backup generator for that reason.
Oh, God.
I didn't know. And that was a problem with one of my Pastor Bruce, is they had sent us a large generator to have people come over and went, how high are you? And they came over with a
fence. Well, two things happened as a result of that power outage, and I don't know how, they're not permanent, but, you know, APS came out, and they set up two generators. Well, they set up a generator and hooked up one. They set up a temporary, they went in, hooked it up at the Isaiah Project, and they left it there for several. Luckily, it was when the second power outage came, and they were able to get that up immediately.
Webinar speaker.
So, the other thing at the First Assembly of God Church, they had the operator, and but they didn't have the equipment to hook it up, you know, to the building permanently. Well, APS came in, they did a temporary hookup, but I know that I believe that they left some equipment behind for them that maybe can accomplish that and have that set up on more of a front base, at least maybe before next year. And but you're right, you know, it's difficult with people that have pets. Some of the hotels do, like I said, the one in the Best Western and Ayrburn. I know there's a couple of the Blythe hotels, you know, that they say...
Yeah, the only problem is a lot of people can't afford.
Well, maybe we can get Richard Chan to do some community service work and we can take all the pets to the super
Good idea.
You know, it's something that needs probably addressed.
Yeah, because it's the love of the lives.
Well, a lot of people will choose to stay with their animals,
right.
And then we'll find you then.
You know, the main thing is that, you know, everybody tries to, you know, if you're here, the power goes out, and make sure that somebody knows that you're there, you know, so that everybody can, again, neighbors can watch over neighbors, you know, when if you need ice, if you need some kind of cooling, if you need help, just tell somebody, you know, and, you know, everybody has... This community, any time that we've had these power outages, you see the community come together, you know, and you do see each other helping one another. And so it's a good thing. I think if we do that, we manage to have gotten by pretty safely on most of these. So, yeah, I think it's working, you know. We don't see everything happening at the time, but I think as individuals, you know, everybody's helping each other out, and we're getting through them. But we need more, something more permanent that provides a refuge. You know, when we know it'll be there, we know it'll be up and running. So.
I don't know if anyone is here that can answer the question. What's the status of the community center? And we kind of figured that whenever that was completed, that would probably be the most likely place people would go to get comfortable.
I don't know if Patricia or anybody, does anybody have any updates on that? Or
it's still in the works.
Okay.
It's not gone away.
I know, you know, economics is tough all over, but I haven't heard anything about it.
Right. Well, I think the last time that question was asked officially or was addressed, that things are still moving along as, you know, as they should be.
It came up, among other reasons, we've had some people stopping at the senior center during the last couple of power outages, thinking we had a genie. We have come into a bit of a financial help to get a generator, and we're now investigating it more seriously. And there's no way we can get a whole building.
Right.
But we're trying to be an emergency shelter. We just went up, we would have to upgrade the AC as well for the small hall to be a place where someone can water color And if it got more serious, maybe like brought my cops or something on the other side, DPS could hook up something on the other side. But one of the issues is real problem. There was a couple of people came, they had no place to stay because they couldn't make a pattern. But, for us, it's in the works as well.
And you know, APS, they called, they wanted to know where they could set up the portable generator. Our senior center was, there was something about the, I don't know, they couldn't hook it up, I guess, as a spray thing.
So simple to APS, and they were still looking at Isaiah, and I don't know what straight the difference.
Yeah, I'm not sure either.
But that may be an option eventually, that if we can get our own Jenny and AC on one side, then APS might be able to bring Jenny on the other side.
Background music.
Question, Jeff?
I don't know. I'll do that.
It's their webinar next door. The speakers are on outside.
Oh. What do you want, Jennifer? How can I help you?
Well, yeah. I noticed that the defendant, Town of Quartzsite, Alex Taft, Jeffrey Gilbert, and Albert Johnson were ordered to a hearing on August 15th at 1:30 p.m. in the Superior Court to show cause for putting those officers on administrative leave. And I was just wondering if you knew yet whether you were going to be represented by the town attorney or by the attorney of the insurance pool.
I have no idea. But we'll be there. I assume.
Now, is this something that we can all attend?
Absolutely.
If that takes place, yeah. What she's referring to, and I won't go into the details of it, is the officers that have been placed on administrative leave have filed an injunction to limit the town's actions as to what they can do and can't do. It's pretty limited. So.
Well, like the man says.
I have a question. I was reading on the internet that there's a group, it's very entertaining sometimes on the internet, but there's a group planning to come into Quartzsite, I believe it's either August 25th or 27th, and their plans to occupy Quartzsite. Now, I've heard that they are meeting at the town park, and I'm just wondering how you might feel about fighters coming in and trying to occupy Quartzsite.
Well, I guess let me start with saying this, that a few weeks ago, there was a lot of propaganda that was put out to the mappers, to the media. I'm sure Jennifer could tell you probably more about that than anything, but as our mayor and Miss Jones and a few other ones, they would go out and tell the world that the town of Quartzsite was martial law, and that the chief of police had taken over the town, and the mayor had been kicked out of office.
Actually, I never made that statement.
And all that sensationalism out there. And what did it do? It attracted the media. Sure, it sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Wow, town's under martial law. There were officers running around here in riot gear and tactical gear. They were suppressing the citizens, you know. I think Jennifer's quote was, you know, she was scared. She was scared to come out of her home. We all know, everybody knows that that wasn't the case, no matter which side of the fence you're on or whatever, that those were complete and out lies.
Well, I never said it.
They were, it was pure propaganda. They were flat out lies. They attracted a lot of attention. But certainly the media realized, you know, that wasn't the case. Now, that information still is continuing to filter out there. Since that time, I still continue to get a numerous hate mail threats, some death threats still, through the through phone messages, emails. And what I found over the course of this time is what they've done is they've appealed to the anti-government group types out there, radical types. And some of these people are very explicit in what they would like to do, as far as what they would like to do when they come into the town, or what they'd like to do personally to myself or anybody else.
I see a question.
Yeah.
Why isn't that a federal crime?
Well, it can be, and it may.
I mean, that's terror. That's domestic terrorism.
Well, since this is the first I've heard of anyone trying to occupy Quartzsite, I'm curious where she got this information.
This is my meeting here. I'm talking.
What I call this
is nothing. What has taken place here, and I have talked to the FBI, I have talked to the Attorney General about it. I've talked to everybody that will listen, and I certainly what has taken place over here over the course of the last few weeks, I certainly consider it to be domestic terrorism.
So I call it.
And when we have a group of people who put out information of that type. What they're trying to do is to create the fear and a scare amongst the people to base up things down. You know, our website was shut down, our emails were shut down, the phones here rang off the hook instantly. You know, so their efforts were basically to shut down the government of Quartzsite. That is domestic, and that is the message that I'm sending to the people who will listen.
Wasn't that what happened when you declared that an emergency exists open-ended? Doesn't that create fear in the community?
May I answer that? That went to the podium and said, I look forward to the day when I no longer feel unsafe in the day. The very people who make me feel unsafe are the people who are claiming to be victims when we're tired of being bitten by them.
Yes. Yeah. When were you bitten by them?
What actually took place, what Jones referring to is the emergency meeting that was held here. The one that Mayor Foster was asked to attend but refused. And the result of that emergency meeting was to set some measures in place to protect the council, the mayor, everybody that sits up there, and you, the public. And that's what it was about. It was about increasing the security measures for everybody in this town because of all of the threats that we had received. All of the hate mail that had been received, all the information was coming in of people who they're trying to attract to come into this town to cause whatever they want to cause. There was no secret meeting. There was no anything. It meant.
So, sort of to get back to what Rain was asking, were you kind of aware that something might be happening on the 25th and 27th?
From my understanding, there's three groups that are planning on coming in on the 27th. I believe that is a Oath Keepers group, I think it's a Tea Party Patriot group, and then there's another one. I can't remember the name of it offhand. I know that there's three groups that are planning on being here on the 27th.
If I can clarify for you, it says it's on supporters of Ed Foster's Facebook page, and it says Occupy and Liberate Quartzsite. Now they have it Thursday, August 25th at 7:30, but they also have it lasting all the way through October 5th, 11 o'clock at night. And I think that's what that is, that's probably just how you set it up in Facebook for an event. And it has three names that created it and what their intentions and a little bit of, you know, the backstory about it. And there's a lot of comments, and they have 22 attending so far.
Okay. You know, hopefully they're a peaceful group. You know, hopefully they're a peaceful group. But I will tell you this, and you know, that a lot of these people that participate in this, by reading the comments, there are people who advocate violence. Mm-hmm.
Well, why don't they just leave if they're not happy?
Well, that is a good question.
Well, we are happy here.
Yeah.
That's why we're here.
Yeah. Me too.
We don't sound like it.
Well, with the exception of one person in this room, I think we're all proud of what the officers are doing.
It's really a difficult, you know, situation that we're going through because you guys know And those of you that attend on a regular basis and other people in the public know that I'm proud of the entire police department, always. I think the community has expressed the same thing back. And, you know, unfortunately for the authors that make complaints, you know, against me, they went about it the wrong way. And had they done it the proper, you know, the proper procedures and the proper way of doing it, we wouldn't be where we're at today with all this mess. And, you know, I don't get it.
What are the proper procedures?
Get a handbook, you'll read it.
Yeah, they know what they are, Jennifer. They're in the policies and procedures of the town and the police department.
That's the same procedure manual that says you were supposed to be placed on leave, right?
On what?
That you were supposed to be placed on administrative leave.
There's nothing that says I was supposed to be placed on leave. That's an interpretation of, I guess, of yours and the mayor's.
Well, it's an interpretation of Judge Bartlett, too.
What it says is the person may be placed on administrative leave. Well, let me rephrase that. Should be if they're not able to perform their job. That's a key question. In the case of myself, I was able to perform my job. What we know now from, since the investigation is made public, that end of it, for those of you who have read it, those of you who haven't, or maybe you haven't read it, what we know from that investigation is that, you know, 99% of this, of their complaints were administrative in nature. Some of these things went back 5 years, you know, 6 years almost of me being here. Some others, according to the report, lied in the report. A lot of it was hearsay. A lot of it was rumor. The only serious thing in that whole thing was the allegation of myself misusing the NCIC system. What I will tell you about that is the DPS is still investigating it. They're making sure they do a thorough job. I appreciate that very much, because all that stuff is computer generated. There's a record of everything. There's a complete record. I recently read something that someone put out here that a certain person was ran 263 times or something of that nature. Ridiculous. Those are sound alike.
No, you ran my husband 263
times. Those are sound alike. How many times?
But do you deny that you ran my husband that many times in a 2-year period?
Your husband who?
John Jones.
Did I ran him how many times?
263 times.
Oh, yes, I did.
What an exaggeration.
Did you clear up how much you did for
me?
No.
Now, the bottom line with that is that will sort itself out. I have complete confidence. I know what I've done in my career. So I don't have any concerns about that part of it. You know, the rest of, unfortunately, these are things that, number one, could have been handled. For some of them that feel like they had legitimate claims, the first step would have been to handle them with me. And, you know, probably just about every one of them could have been handled that way. The next step would have been handled for all, if they had official complaints, it would have been handled by management. But we're where we're at today. You know, and it's a difficult situation. These are men and women of the department that I had confidence and that I believed in. And, you know, two of them since come back to work this week. And, you know, that's the way it is. And we'll have to wait to see, you know, just like I do, we'll have to wait to see how the rest of the investigation comes out. I don't want to say I apologize, but in explanation, I guess, over the course of the last, since the middle of May, I've remained pretty silent about, you know, about what's going on for the most part. And certainly people, you know, have commented that, why aren't you saying more? Why aren't you talking to the press? Why aren't you doing these things? For the same reasons that what happened at the meeting where, they brought in the officers and the ASCOP groups and that, because you got to let these things run its course. You know, when these investigations are going on, you know, it's not proper for me to go out and speak about, you know, it's not proper for the other authorities to. So the reason for me being a little more outspoken now is that, you know, the part of that investigation is done. The DPS investigation, when it's completed, and you got to remember, it's a very narrowly scoped investigation. It's about the NCIC they use. That will sort itself out when they look at the records. When they look at it, it will all come together. And so, but I will be more vocal about it because it needs the true story needs to be told.
The true story.
Proof.
For $11, you can buy a copy at Superior Court.
You know, want to waste your money on it. $11? Wow.
You know, the county's got to make up that $14 million deficit. So.
Yeah. They're obviously not, you're...
Good job, Jeff.
I know I'm paying my share. So. It's unfortunate, you know, it really is. You know, I've seen so many lives damaged already because of this, and it's sad. It really is sad. And I wish nothing bad for the officers that I've, and I know ultimately, you know, they and their families are going to be, there's going to be some devastation. There already have been, you know. Imagine how I felt when, you know, nine of my police officers, you know, did what they did. You know, the bad thing about it is the way they went about it, you know, their alignment with the political groups out here that I think did more damage to them than anything. And I don't know. It's really a shame. It's really a shame. And I hope that for those that ultimately come back, like I said, act. I can tell you this, they're very regretful as to what happened. This was really over a promotion of two sergeants. That's really what started this whole thing. And it's, I don't know.
Danger of jealousy.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You can go very deep. And then when you get on, you know, when unfortunately, you know, even in the realm of police officers, you can have a lot of peer pressure. You can have a lot of bullying. And it's scary for cops, you know, or scary for anybody that may be in a position where they, you know, where their jobs may be on the line. Yeah.
Did you mention that complete report is available in the library and it's on CD also? If anybody wants to take the trouble to read.
How much is the CD?
$25.
Yeah.
Well, you know, investing the $25 CD, you'll get a lot more out of them than that $14 general yeah. expense, so, whatever it was.
Not mine. I think there's 200 exhibits in
the pages. You know, the only thing I ask from the community is this, that have faith in the department. Continue to have faith that you've always shown in the department. We will, whatever rebuilding we have to do as a department, we will do that. And you will have, regardless of whether it's officers that stay on board or somewhere down the road, you see new faces, whatever happened, you know. If my face wasn't here and there was a new face in place of me, have confidence that you'll have a good department. Mm-hmm. And any of the problems that we have, we will fix them. And I am not, I am not a perfect person. And I make mistakes as well as anybody else does. But I can assure you this, that I didn't create this mess.
But you're doing a very good job hanging in there while it resolves itself.
Yeah. And it will.
This is not a fast train to hell we're on.
What would you call it? Line to liberation?
It's a slow boat to town solidarity.
It will. You know, I always say that, you know, when something bad happens, you know, something good will happen in this place. And eventually there will be good out of it, you know. And maybe the good is that there's a cleansing, you know. Maybe the good is, you know, there's a lot of things.
I think we ought to thank the police officers here. It isn't like a normal job. They live under stress every minute they walk out the door, half time in the home. Yep. And if somebody stirs them up a little bit and gets something bad going like this, they're happy as hell, and it disrupts the whole damn town.
Yeah. Yeah. You're absolutely right. And it is a stressful job. There's a few of you in here that know that. And, you know, even when we're not here, you know, when we're not here, when we don't have the uniform on, when we're not doing this, it's a lot of stress. And, you know, that's one of the reasons why, you know, I've always kept in the department, which ultimately were brought up as some issues in that. You know, we're a small agency, you know, we're 13 people. And you try to keep, because of the stresses of the jobs and that, you try to keep a little bit of a light atmosphere going in the department, you know. You want officers to be able to kind of joke around with each other and be friendly and have an opportunity to release some of that stress. You know, some of those things may change. You know, the department that we end up will probably be a more disciplined department. But you'll have good people out here taking care of you, I guarantee that. And, you know, the officers that remained loyal, and not to me, the officers that remained loyal to you, to this community. That's why, you know, did participate in this. It wasn't about me. It's about the community. It was about remaining loyal to you, all of you, loyal to their job, loyal to what's right and what's wrong. And so we're going to be fine.
Jeff, Rain's working on her best of Quartzsite for the newspaper, so maybe we can suggest a favorite police officer to go into that best of
Quartzsite.
So.
Anthony? All right. Well, someone else picked in. Yeah. No, but you know, you guys, what you're doing or how you're doing it, it's got a committee or whatever you have, but
I think Rain,
I'm sure there's people here that could have input on that. You know, officers are, you know, every officer is different. You know, you have one officer that, you know, could probably sit here and talk to you all day long, you know. Bless you if you got or you got an old car, a classic car sitting in your driveway, you know. Sergeant Schultz, he'd probably sit there and talk to you about it all day long. You know. And other officers are not always, you know, that friendly, you know. Doesn't mean they're not a good officer. You know. It's just a personality, you know. We're all a human too. So, and we have personalities. We have good days, we have bad days. You know, so.
Could you tell us when the gun shop, what the expected date of, I guess, not opening, breaking ground?
I don't know, and I wasn't at the last council meeting. I don't know if...
there's a couple of months.
Sometime, though, this year?
Oh, yeah, for sure. They want it open for the season.
Oh, so it will be up and running.
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
I understand there's a little bit of controversy maybe about that, or at least...
Let me go find out.
Okay. During the last meeting or whatever, I guess, or something. In fact, actually, it's going to be in the property that I think is kind of right across the street from the police department.
Well, I think it's
Kitty Corner.
Yeah.
It's Kitty Corner North.
Mm-hmm. What is it?
It's Kitty Corner North of the police department.
Yeah. What I seen of the plans a month or so ago was a indoor retail area, and that they had plans for a possible expansion of an indoor shooting range. But I think that was going to be down the road.
Second phase.
Yeah, second phase. And that was, I think, successful they were as a retail operation. But it's a, you know, stick-built building that has security features built in. And, you know, so, I, you know, hopefully it's a good addition to the community. And we certainly have a lot of...
They are projecting to be open for this season. So... Yeah.
We get people from all over the country that are
new weapons
and advocates and the like. So,
and either of those people, terrorists, the ones that might be frequenting this business, then?
No,
just curious.
I wouldn't think so. I would hope not. You know, I don't think because someone, you know, terrorist doesn't have to have a gun. Terrorist doesn't.
Oh, they can have a computer.
No, all they need is
all he needs is a computer now.
Terrorism can come in a lot of different forms besides a physical violence.
One day a Wild Wild West.
You said that the promotion to sergeant was the impetus for the complaints against you. I was just going to comment on the fact that as a requirement for that promotion, in your own words, you set the requirement as must live in the immediate area, and then you promoted someone who lives 2.5 hours away. Would you like to comment as to why you broke your own protocol requirement for that promotion?
I'm the chief of police, Jennifer, in case you haven't noticed, I'm still here.
Me too.
Okay. Yeah, I can. Those are my choices as to what requirements I want to make.
No rebuttal.
Did you guys? Does everyone know who the two sergeants that were selected or not? Sergeant James Schultz and Sergeant Fabiola Garcia. Mm-hmm. Jim, of course, most of you know if you've lived here for any length of time. And you know, Jim has about 16 years, 5 years, is that right?
He's a lieutenant colonel, too.
About 16 years, right, with the department. And he's a lieutenant colonel in the Army Reserve. He's been here his whole career. I think one of the things that a lot of people don't know about Sergeant Garcia, she has about 17 years experience as a certified officer. I think about 8 or 9 of those years were with Buckeye PD. And then she had, I think, about 10 years with the Department of Liquor Control. And those are certified police officers that work for that agency. They, some of them are. You know, and there's a lot of, you know, I often say this, and I will help kind of explain to you. So you know what in here does. And, you know, a larger agency, a police sergeant, is probably going to go out and he's going to supervise a group of men and women, you know, during a shift, you know, on patrol. And he's going to be responsible for them, what they do. And, you know, in a larger department, you know, that sergeant's probably going to answer to a lieutenant, who might answer to a captain, who might answer to an assistant chief, who, you know, or maybe, you know, there may be a number of those positions throughout the organization. And a patrol sergeant may not ever come across, you know, dealings with the chief, very rarely, you know. Maybe at a wards function or something of that nature. You know, but we're a small agency, very small agency. And the sergeants that I have here are not just patrol sergeants. You know, they are an extension of the chief of police. You know, they may be the chief one day. They may be someday and they have to do criminal investigation or oversee something. You know, there's a lot of things that they do besides just patrol sergeants. And that's why the selection, when they're done, at least for this agency and how I do them, it's a much broader scope than just the title of patrol sergeant. They're responsible for many, many things. So.
I'd like to say that Officer Garcia has had a very positive impact on my family. Just the other day, my daughter decided to sign up for criminal justice because Officer Garcia patrolling our village, seeing just that role model of a woman, has caused my daughter to want to become a police officer in this town someday. And I had been waiting for all of my children to set the roots here the way that I decided to do a year and a half ago. We've been nomadic for 12 years. And it's just thrilling to watch my offspring start putting their own little down in the ground.
Well, it's great, you know, and especially in this time, when there is turmoil, you know, within the department, and still that she recognizes a role model that wants to do something. That's really neat. And I think as cops, all of us, you know, I've heard me say this before, just somebody saying thank you, you know, application and that, and the word that anybody could ever give, you know, for all the times that we are disliked and that kind of thing. Just somebody saying thank you, hearing something like that, you know, that they had an impact on somebody.
And your new officer, Rick Patterson, I remember when you introduced him, the quote that he gave, do not tolerate domestic violence because it affects us all. And I remember one time at Coffee with Cops, you said that y'all never get invited to little Johnny's birthday. Time you get to go to the party is when there's domestic violence, you're called in.
Right.
And usually little Johnny has to watch something that's not as much fun as opening his gifts.
Yeah.
And I appreciate your honesty regarding the challenges that you face. Domestic violence is a serious problem. It does affect us all. And as long as we remember that, we can practice prevention and stay proactive regarding whatever bullying is in front of us.
Who are the two officers that have been taken off administrative leave and are actively involved in our community again?
That would be Officer Rubicata and Officer Villafania.
Who?
Villafania. Ruben Villafania, Alex Rubicata.
Wow. That's just a mouthful.
Yeah.
Wow. Ruben and Ruben.
Yeah.
Okay.
Alex
and Ruben.
Hey, Chief, there's one thing I want to say. Months and months ago, there was an article for about a certain RV park here getting their lights shined in their windows every night. I just want to thank the officer that goes by the shelter, and we're on the far end of town, wakes the dogs up every night. However, it wakes me up knowing they're there.
Yes.
And that thing for patrolling all the way out there. I'm the last house resident in the city. And they go all the way down our dirt road, go all the way around Choya, just to make sure the RV park is safe, also that's next door to me. I do appreciate the officer being out there. I don't care if the dog's barking, I just can't tell them to shut up. I appreciate it.
Yeah, well, thank you. You know, it's you know, we have a lot of property around here to check on, you know, and it's, you know, even, you know, if you got two or three people out there, you know, it's hard to get to every place, but they're doing their best.
It's a night, I hear the dogs go off, I open my shade, it's the officer, I shut it, go out, tell the dogs to shut, go ahead, and then I'll fly down, go back to bed.
I wish they drive around in our park a little bit more because it causes their excitement. Everybody's like, oh, what's going on? I saw that. What did they call? I'm going to call someone.
You want lights and sirens? Well, you know, it's kind of funny. You know, we were, as you mentioned, you know, there have been a few of the parks around here that have trespassed us, you know, off of their property, you know, the police. And, you know, it's almost comical in a sense, you know, who would not want their, you know, to be able to have a police officer their need when they want. There have been here that's been blocking the driveway, you know, with a pickup truck with a big sign in the back of it. What would happen if he needed an emergency home back there? And they can't get that, you know. It's to me, it's senseless, you know. If you don't like the police, then fine, you don't like the police. But I tell you what, even people who don't like police may need to have a need for us one day.
Oh, yeah.
And we're never going to question, you know, we're never going to question one's position, where they stand, whether they like us, whether they don't like us ever. When anyone calls for help, we're going to be there, regardless. And that's what we do.
report.
I'm just thankful that you don't react like police stations in Los Angeles and Phoenix, because they come in heavy and hard, and then once they determine everything's okay, you don't have it like you do. You come up with a smile and you're assessing it as you're going along, and threatening. And then they have to threaten, in other words, to save their lives. They don't know who to deal with.
Well, it's a different life. I mean, you know, the urban environment is much different than what we have here. And, you know, it's policing and how you do it is different. You know, I was trained at the Phoenix Academy, and for those, you know, the inner city academies they train you a little bit differently. There's some, you know, we have an kid ran out of Lake Havasu, and the training there is geared a little more towards the rural environment. So, it makes it different where you work and how police react. You know, I'm in Phoenix where, when the cops roll up, they got to look at it. You know, they're watching their back left and right, and they're worried, you know, you don't know who's going to come out for them.
The cop got shot in South Dakota. Traffic stop. Bam. Two of them got shot and one got killed.
Yeah. Right. We know it can happen here, too.
That's right. Yeah.
There's
no more crime that's not urban or rural.
Well, overall, it's more dangerous for rural police officers than it's for inner city. There's all, you know, typically you got plenty of backup around, you know, around the corner, you know, but you know, some faces here, they know what I'm talking about. When you're out here, oftentimes you're, and backup might be a long way away. If at all. Yeah.
You just call us, wow.
And you know, you're around the corner, and even that might not be enough time. And, you know, cops, you know, I mean, we all, as humans, we all develop our senses, you know. And cops certainly, if they're smart, they pay attention to their senses. And you know, so sometimes, you know, you may, you know, cut him up and said he may not be the friendliest guy in the world, but maybe something's telling him, you know, there's something wrong. You know, he's going to be a little more cautious.
I had the honor of hearing a testimony from someone who met several officers one day when he, old man, was trying to get rid of his wife's kid after 5 or 6 years dead. And he thought he had a handle on it, and he was drinking his beer, and he was taking his meds. But once he put all the stuff in the truck, and it was no longer in the trailer, he flipped out. And it took tasering him, and it took this, and it took that. And when I saw him again a month later, after he had gone to a hospital, he told me he was so grateful that the police understood that he was tense his strength in that moment, and that they did what they had to do for his safety, and he felt that, even though he was out of his mind and incoherent on an intuitive level, he was happening for him and to him was going to change his life, and he is now a very, very happy man on his way to recovery from alcoholism and pill addiction, and he's finally doing the proper breathing, last I heard, he says, I want to give the police department $1,000 to show my appreciation.
For being tasered?
Maybe I missed part of it. You talking about here locally?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That was in Councilman Lucas's park, right?
What's that?
Wasn't that the one in Councilman Lucas's park?
I'm not sure where
it is. This doesn't have anything to do with council, but actually. It has to do with a man who was grieving horribly 4 years later and destroying his body and his mind as a result. And thanks to our police department, he is now on his way.
You know, and he came in, and I think that says a lot certainly about the person, you know, recognizing maybe his demons and that, but you know, he did kind of feel awesome personally. Mm-hmm. And again, it goes back to what I was saying. You know what that means? You know, that means everything. And even though, right, and even those are situations where, you know, we have to use some type of force, physical force. Many times with people like that, it's, you know,
on a couple of occasions in my career, I remember people get in touch with me from prison and say, thank you for putting me in prison.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
How long do you figure until this alignment's all over with and you'll get back to full force and you get back to doing your duties as you're supposed to be instead of playing this other game?
Well, you know, we are doing our regular duties.
I'm sure we're doing the best you can.
There are no circumstances.
But we're back to full force. And
you know, we'll have to wait and see how the rest of this investigation pans out. Two of the officers are back. It's difficult, you know. They're going to be faced with, there's a large part of this community, especially that were here that night in that council meeting where we had a near riot, in an alignment of, you know, officers on one wall and the rest of the, you know, the few officers that were on duty. And, you know, there's, you know, these officers may have a hard time, you know, but I, you know, they went through a process, you know, they went through the process and they came back to work. So we'll get through that. We'll get through the problems of that. And they're going to go out there and they're going to do their job. And I think as far as the timeline on the rest of it, I think certainly probably within the next couple of weeks we'll know where everything's going to shake out, you know, so to speak. And then we'll see, you know, if there's a rebuilding of the department that we need to do, then we should be able to do that pretty efficiently.
We should have a
Over the course of this last year, I've been able to put a pretty extensive list of you know, cops that were out of work or laid off or whatever, you know, that are looking for jobs, you know. But we're not going to rush into anything. You know, just like right now, we certainly are able to handle the call volume. It's going to go up here in a couple months. You know, we're going to start seeing the call volumes go up, and the service is going to get more demand. But we'll be ready for it. There's a few donuts left up here, you know, at 9 o'clock, and you guys know I'll just keep talking. I don't think you have enough of me.
I wasn't sure if they're trying to get well enough to make a comment about a gun shop and a donut shop, but it's a gun shop.
Huh?
Yeah.
In there, Jerry.
Both of our good buildings.
Take care of that butterfly. You got to keep that straight up, huh?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Do they have an exchange?
Not an exchange, George, but they're going to be so cheap. They'll come in, they'll let me up.